Hi everybody. Welcome to today's session on Kotlin. So we have like quite a few awesome people here. Thank you Hasvik, and thank you Zeno for putting this together. So we have got Madhu from Able.do. We've got Pulkit from Coding Blocks, and we've got Rohan from Red Hat. All of them have been using Kotlin in different ways in their work, and Pulkit even teaches people using Kotlin. So we will be discussing a bunch of things today. So we will take up questions for people who are just going to start beginning with Kotlin, and how to migrate into Kotlin from your existing language. What are the places where Kotlin makes things interesting? And we'll start off with that. We will move on to some of the things that people who are already using Kotlin for a while love to discuss about, like things where say usually people make common mistakes when they're using Kotlin. What are the places that Kotlin makes life really better? We have heard about things like coroutines in Kotlin makes it much more easier to handle with threads and everything. And then we would end up in the session discussing more of the experimental and upcoming opportunities that we have with Kotlin. Things like people are using Kotlin for writing even iOS apps these days, how that kind of stuff is done. You can in fact write front end Kotlin JS. You can write Kotlin and Kotlin turns into JS, all of that stuff. So we'll discuss a few of those things. I think to get started with, I would just like to go to each one of you one by one and quickly introduce yourselves in just a minute, like, and what has been your journey till now working on Kotlin and all. So I think Madhu, maybe you can start.
Sure. Hey everyone, I was Madhu here. I lead engineering at Able. We are a consulting company for mobile and web applications. I am a polyglot developer. I work across different stacks, both on server and mobile. I've been using Kotlin on Android for a long time now, almost 3 to 4 years. The good thing that I liked about Kotlin is a lot of boilerplate coming from the Java world. Kotlin has completely gotten rid of. And it really feels modern. Android development finally feels modern. When I come from web development, everything is like hot reloading is there, it's super fast, then web tests are there. The language, pretty good. Support in Android, we are just stuck with this old Java system with XMLs, and we are thrown back into a kind of very slow process. But Kotlin tries to nicely fit everything there. Language expressivity is great. There are a great set of features that we're going to talk about very soon. But overall, my experience with Kotlin has been amazing, and I've also gotten a chance to experiment with multi-platform, and it really shined there. And there is a great effort in the community to actually get multi-platform into a very good state. So for a multi-platform iOS and Android application, some of the important things are database related things, right? You want your database to be shared across both platforms, and serialization, right? How you serialize your entities. So I think they are trying to, the community has been putting great efforts in terms of SQL Delight and Kotlin X serialization. And I have an extremely positive feeling about how Kotlin multi-platform would work out in the future. Other things also are like coroutines. We'll probably discuss that more detail when we
talk. Definitely, definitely. About you, Pulkit. So how has your experience with Kotlin been? What are the things that you use Kotlin for in your life?
Okay. So first of all, right now I'm working at Coding Blocks. I teach Android development there, and I do make courses as well. And along with that, I do some development stuff. And along with the Coding Blocks, I'm right now part of the Google Summer of Code at Opia. So OPI is an open source project that deals with the tech stuff, like ed tech. So yeah, so far, with the Kotlin, I've been using Kotlin for like 2 years, and I started Kotlin using when I joined CB as an intern. So at that time, I started using the Kotlin, and so far the journey has been, I would say, great. I learned a lot about things that I didn't know about even at the time of Java. But right now, I know a lot of things that do happen in Java and that do happen in Kotlin. There are some fallbacks, there are some pitfalls about the language. But otherwise, the experience with the language has been quite good. And in fact, I recently launched a course on Kotlin. We had about 5,000 enrollments of the course, and the response for the audio from the users was great. They loved the language. They got it into the language. They liked the language. Even I do love, even whenever I do write something in the Kotlin, I fall in love with the language. That is a very, I would say, modern language, and it feels great to write code in Kotlin. So yeah, that's been my journey with the Kotlin.
Okay. Nice. I think we'll have more questions for you as we go ahead. And Rohan, hey, what about you? What all are you doing these days? And so how has your relationship with Kotlin been till now? Oh, I think you are on mute.
Am I audible now?
Yeah.
So I also started my journey with the coding blocks. I started with the Android development and got to know when I started Android development, it was Java first, and Kotlin was just an introduction. So first feature which I liked was data classes, because that was the first feature I was introduced with. And then data classes literally reduced a lot of boilerplate code. Then slowly I moved into the language itself. Then the most important impactful thing was for me coroutines. I started to go deeper into the coroutine stuff and got to know that coroutines is not nothing new which Kotlin introduced, but the way Kotlin introduced the coroutines is way different. I mean, it really makes the coding for the coroutines is very grateful. Coroutines existed in Go language, but still Go language wasn't that much successful with Go routines. Kotlin made it really seamless and functional. After that, I got into some native stuff, experimented with a little bit Kotlin native, and made some like little library for the Android and Linux, the common multi-platform library. And then currently I am working at Red Hat and adding the Kotlin support for Quarkus framework. So the Quarkus is a web framework, which has a very less boot time as compared to Spring Boot. So you can say Quarkus is another framework, another Java or Kotlin framework into the world of web frameworks like Ktor and Spring Boot. But what we are targeting is less boot time for the least boot time for the web framework, and the less memory consumption, the less memory footprint. Currently, Spring Boot and Ktor are, I mean, they are working on the JVM thing. They are working on the JVM, so they have the that basic memory footprint, the high memory footprint. But the Quarkus, they use a GraalVM, so we have less memory footprint. And the integration of and Quarkus is also Kubernetes, and I mean Kubernetes integrated platform, so you can easily deploy your application to the cloud frameworks. So currently I'm adding the Kotlin support in that framework, and also I am a GSOC mentor for Quarkus and helping a student regarding the Gradle support.
Oh, nice. So I think great round of introductions. What I'd like to delve into, and everybody who is watching, if you have any questions, especially like, you know, beginner questions, like about getting started with Kotlin, anything that you want to ask about that, you know, what are the reasons somebody should move to Kotlin, or, and if you're trying to move to Kotlin right now, any challenges anybody is facing and somebody wants to ask something about that, that. Please go ahead and ask questions along those lines. You'll definitely pick those up from the YouTube messages when Rudy sends across. But I do have my some questions that I wanted to go ahead and ask to begin with right in the beginning is, how and I will go to all three of you one by one. Do you think like, Kotlin is just a language that, is for people who were using Java earlier and now it's, just a language to replace that? Or do you feel like when you look at Kotlin, it has its own world and maybe like, it makes sense to use Kotlin even for people who were not writing Java before? It just makes sense in itself. It is a great thing. What are your views on that? Whether like if you're working on any project, if it's a a server project or an Android project, does every project written in Java should it be rewritten to Kotlin? Should we all migrate to Kotlin and leave Java? So because a lot of people beginning they have questions around this direction, because if you look at the Android development world, like the way the Google messages things, they say forget Java, everything is going to be Kotlin now. So what do you think about that? Moving to Kotlin. So I think maybe we'll do the same order. Madhu, what are your views? I still mute. I think I need to unmute yourself. Yeah,
I should get used to this mute. Sorry. I wouldn't say all the use cases of Java would migrate to Kotlin. First, I would say that because I'll give you one bad thing and then talk about all good things. One thing that actually happened with us in our recent project is, we were trying to use, let's say, MongoDB with a Java project, and the Kotlin data classes serialization is not straightforward there. So it involves a lot of hacks, right? So for the purposes of saving time and moving ahead with the project, we didn't spend time, but that was something we definitely wanted to explore, where we wanted to put data classes in Kotlin and have them shared with Android project too. And I would say we have not been successful, but I would definitely want to go in that direction in future. As far as other places are concerned, Android development, where it is actually picking a lot of more steam than any other place in the developer ecosystem. So people can directly get started with Kotlin. I don't think they should have a Java background. It's definitely not necessary. And especially when people start with Kotlin, they might feel more closer to Android development today than they would have felt before, I guess. Coming from the days of Android development where we were using Ant to build the project, to the Gradle, to KTS now, I think I've seen a phenomenal improvement, and the new users who start Android development should definitely jump onto Kotlin and do not have to look into Java at all. Definitely not necessary. And a great deal of Android architecture components, Jetpack, a lot of things that are pushed from Android side, I think are heavily Kotlin friendly, and even the code looks much, much better. So I would advise people to start with Kotlin if they could.
Right.
But if they've already started with Java and they want to migrate to Kotlin, right? IntelliJ has great set of tools, right? The first thing you could try, the first immediate thing, paste code in Java and see how it looks in Kotlin, right? That would be your immediate action to try out something. And there are a great deal of tools available in IntelliJ, right? You can double shift action convert to Kotlin. Right. Other thing is people, I think, would definitely get overwhelmed by the number of features that Kotlin has. Whenever people, Kotlin developers talk, they talk about a lot of things, right? They talk about objects, they talk about classes, data classes, sealed classes, a lot of things. So my suggestion for beginners, don't get overwhelmed by those. Don't try to get into all features and try to see if you can fit those things in your app. But read through some of the popular repositories, understand the code. I'm sure out of 100 features, probably you will use only a handful of features every day, right? Yeah. Um, so, So that's my take on Kotlin for beginners. If you're coming from Java world, quickly change, use the migration tools, change, see how your code looks, right? And secondly, don't definitely don't get bogged down into the features and the awesome things that everybody talks about, right? Take one or two things, study, you know, understand them, try to use them, and then slowly move into the deeper parts. Because I myself have moved from Java to Kotlin, and there were little, given my experience with dealing with a lot of different programming languages, sometimes it does feel overwhelming.
Right. So I'll, there's actually a question from one of the attendees also is somebody asks if they don't know Java, but they know C#, and can they start learning Kotlin? So as I moved to, you know, Pulkit, I think, so you have been teaching a lot of people basic Kotlin, like, you know, Kotlin as a language itself, not specifically from an Android perspective or something. So we'll take the last question, of course, expanding upon that, you know, whether everybody should learn Kotlin or not. Along with that, like, when you teach, like, you know, the basics of Kotlin to somebody compared to if you want to teach the basics of a language, like, say, you know, Java or C# to somebody. Is Kotlin, do you think it's easier to learn? And do you recommend learning Kotlin to people, whether or not they want to, you know, learn Android later on? Some people might want to learn Android, some people might want to do something else as well. Do you like recommend in general people to learn Kotlin, or do you think people should learn Java, then only they should learn Kotlin? What are your thoughts on that, Pulkit?
So my thoughts on that, like, I have taught a lot of people in the past, and the only thing that I feel that people should not directly start from the Kotlin, the basic, there are certain things about the explicit typecasting or the implicit typecasting that we have, or type inference that we get in the Kotlin. Like, we don't have to give any type to that, to any variable. So that is actually not true. People should know about that there is a type, there's a type of any variable, and you should give the type to the variable. Otherwise, you can't work with that. So you should have these kind of things. You should know about these things. And I would also say that you should know about the concept of oops. If you start with the Kotlin for the oops, you might get confused about something, like there's a singleton pattern, there's an object pattern, then there is a companion object. There are a lot of things in Kotlin which are does not really apply to the oops. And I as an Android developer or any developer, I prefer that people should know a good knowledge about the oops before starting with any development. Oops is a basic building blocks of everything. If you don't know oops, I wouldn't say that you can start with Android dev or any dev. If you know a basic set of oops, that should be good to go. So learning about Kotlin, like whether you should learn Kotlin or not. So it doesn't matter that you are an Android dev or you are a computer programmer, but it doesn't matter. You should learn a language. Like if you see in the last year, this year, what happens at in the ICPC, that is the competition for the competitive programming. So they have introduced Kotlin as a language, and people have started using Kotlin as a language in competitive programming too. Although I know that that would be as good as C++, so which can be as good as C++, that we all know. But yes, you can definitely learn the Kotlin language. There are a good set of features that does make make your work easier. Like recently, I got to know about a function in Kotlin that is called join to string. And I love that feature. Like I used to write that on my own, and when I actually learned how to use that feature or the function, I use that function a lot of where I do, used to do that thing manually. So yeah, my take is that you should definitely learn Kotlin, whether you are an Android dev or you are a competitor or you are even starting with some server language. You can definitely learn Kotlin, but you should have basic knowledge of oops. And that should be done in some other language which does not have this set of features, like especially like type inference and anything like this.
Good. I'll just round it off by going to Rohan. I see some good questions also coming in. I think, for example, Bhargav and Ravi, they have asked about specifics about the language. I'm just going to those questions very soon. Like the next segment, we'll actually take a look up on some specific coding structures like objects and statics that you're saying. So we'll definitely go to that. I'll just finish this round by asking Rohan. So what has your experience been about getting started with a language, and your opinions also about whether somebody should directly pick up Kotlin or not, and what do you think are prerequisites for starting to learn Kotlin? Is there some other language people should learn before that? And how much does Kotlin make sense for general use case as well, not just specifically Android, but I think you are using Kotlin in a non-Android use case as well. So how is it growing in there? Yeah.
So I would first say that if a person is, split the use cases. Let's suppose if a person is starting with a competitive, then there the language pickup doesn't, make so much a difference. You can pick up Kotlin over there, and Kotlin would be easily, and you could easily grasp the, Kotlin will help you over the, focus on the algorithms, because Kotlin does give you a really nice set of features, and the collections library of the Kotlin, which has a lot of features and a lot of functions readily available as compared to Java and other C++ templates library. Then if you are going for the competitive, I would say you can pick up the Kotlin, but as I said, it would be only for competitive. Then you would be only focused on DS and Elgo. Then Kotlin is fine. You can go with it. Now let's come to a development stuff. Suppose you are picking up Android or non-Android platform, like server side or backend development, right? So there, we should know first that we should know first the background of Kotlin. The Kotlin started with the JVM language only. The first thing the JetBrains introduced the Kotlin as a JVM language only, and it is still based on the JVM only. So you should know about the basics of JVM, how the JVM works. Many features, you don't necessarily have to see the all the structures of Java, how it is written in Java and how it is written in Kotlin. But yeah, you should definitely know how the JVM stuff works, how the object works, how the objects are created in the heap. These kind of things you should know. And yeah, as the Pulkit said, I would second that the Pulkit said about the types, that Kotlin has a nice feature of type inference, but yeah, it is just for the developer's simplicity, that I know that it is of this type, it would be fine. And it is also for developer, it is for simplified the developer's productivity. And but if you are starting with the Kotlin, then I don't think so that you should just directly jump into type inference thing, because later on you would, let's suppose if you're seeing your code after 2 to 3 months, even 5 to 6 months, you would be confused. Okay, what was the type? So type inference thing is a use, is a feature for the somehow intermediate to experienced developers. Then now come to Kotlin is expanding to other platforms as well. It is not only restricted to JVM. It is moved to native and multi-platform stuff. For that, I would say, the same thing applies. You should know on which platform you are applying. Like Android is a JVM-based thing, and so you should know how the JVM works. And now if you're targeting the Kotlin for Linux apps, because I made a library for the Linux too, so you should know what are the basic function which the Linux supports. So that's are the thing you should consider. What platform are you targeting? Kotlin is a language which give you basically cool features over there and helps you with the productivity. But if you're not familiar with the platform you're targeting, it won't help you.
Right. So good set of points. I'll take up another question Ravi has a question. What kind of Android app or games should we target first when we want to get a good hands-on experience on Kotlin? So that's the question. If any one of you wants to get ahead with the question, then we will delve more into actual some code samples, and we can share our screens and discuss some more patterns of coding as well. But yeah, if anybody wants to take up this question, what kind of Android apps or games should we target first when if you want to get a good hands-on experience in Kotlin? Anybody wants to go ahead? Madhu, I think you're on mute. Yeah.
I'll take care of that. So I think when you want to get hands-on experience, right, there are two things. You know Android already and you want hands-on experience on Kotlin, right? That is one. And you don't know Android and you're trying Kotlin. So these are the two different things, right? So if you already know Android app, so you could pick up something that not at the level of games, because that's not probably where you would want a lot of. See, we write app logic in Kotlin. Games, game development could be, you know, spanning across, you know, your C code, C++ code and Kotlin. Right. So I would probably suggest an app development that involves, if you're coming from an Android background and want to start Kotlin, is something that involves a database, basically a storage, that involves a network call. Right? You can think of any app, but the, you know, fundamental should be a storage layer for you, a network layer, because that practically taps into how people are practically writing Kotlin, right? How you make a network call, do a display on the device, and then store it on the database, right? And people who really want to actually try out Kotlin without prior experience on Android, I would say aim low, start with some samples on the Android platform. First, figure out because when you start with Android, it's just not plain Kotlin that you are writing. You are writing into a Kotlin that Android expects. So there are some components to it. So if you have to run your Kotlin code, maybe your activity has to be displayed. Yes. Right? That's the first time probably you would see your Kotlin code working. But if you just want to try out Kotlin, I would definitely suggest put this all aside, fire up your IntelliJ editor and start writing Kotlin classes. If you, as Pulkit mentioned, right? If you're good at understanding groups and write a bunch of classes, write a function with main, and then you can get started. And Kotlin also has this nice feature of scripting. So if you are not really into classes and calling things, you can actually fire up, you can just write a Kotlin script and execute it as a script, right? So these are the various ways I see that you can actually do a hands-on exploration.
I think I can add on to that is I am a very, very big proponent of play.kotlinlang.org. It's a great website. Go to play.kotlinlang.org. If you go to kotlinlang.org, there's a top right corner, there's a link for the playground. And, you can do a bunch of stuff. You can, try to think. Maybe, in fact, I can share my screen as well. Just a moment. So, yeah, I'm... is that visible? The Kotlin playground on my screen.
Yep.
Yeah. So he's just a very, very small example. You just go to play.kotlin.org. You can try out stuff like this. There's a run button. You click on that, and as you can see, it's one of the fastest. Code executors online. Also, I can see Kotlin people have JetBrains people have put in some effort into that, and they have done this. So you can go here, and you can just share that as well. Piece of code you can share to somebody. You just want to show a small snippet of code to somebody and ask, is this the right way of doing it or is it not the right way of doing it, like that. So there are such playgrounds for almost every language to start with. I have seen, like, these days, TypeScript, Swift, Dart, all modern languages, they have the creators of the languages, they usually make such an online playground, right? There are a lot of online IDs also. I think we have at Coding Blocks also, we have an online ID. That's the very first step. You can just go there, try out, playing around with the language, because if you have basic programming knowledge, you have basic idea of object-oriented programming and all in some other language, then you can just, try out a lot of different things here. You can go to, of course, the Kotlin examples, and, we can just open up a particular example, say, how to create enums in Kotlin, and you can then click on the play button. it starts running. So I think that's also a great way to learn. Like learning by doing, this is something I really love and I suggest people to do as well. I think that kind of rounds up most of our questions around, I think, how to get started with Kotlin, why to get started with Kotlin, and when you do get started with Kotlin, what are the things you should take care of. If there are more questions around, you know, this about the beginning part, you know, where Kotlin makes sense, where it does not, please feel free to, you know, ask further questions. But I'd move ahead into, you know, more actual specifics of actually using Kotlin. So, you know, I see somebody has asked, so Bhargav has asked this, what's your thought about people using, you know, objects in Kotlin? Any drawback for using object for declaring constant and also for declaring static method? So I think what probably Bhargav wants to ask is, maybe if I just open IntelliJ window. So yeah. So let's just say, I mean, take this question forward, and I would like to ask views from you guys as well. So if I create, say, for example, a Java class, and this is something that we do a lot, is basically create maybe a, you know, we create a class in Java. The purpose of this class is largely to hold, say, you know, const. So maybe let's say we have a class which is called, rather than that, like a const like this. You find this kind of code very frequently in your code base, right? You have got a lot of public static final string. Let's say, you know, you have some tag there. Maybe you have some, you know, something like base URL here, which is something, you know, stuff like that. And you know, another thing is you might have some, you know, another pattern that people use a lot is having util functions. So, for example, create another class. Here's say utils class, and it has. It returns something here. Okay, I'm just not fleshing this function out. I'm just asking maybe if there's a URL and there is a path to it, and it appended that path into it, whatever. Okay, so you have this kind of util functions, and you're using it from the rest of the part of your code a lot. You call URL to string, utils dot URL to string from a lot of your parts of your code. So you have this utils classes with a bunch of static functions, and you have got lots of const classes with a lot of public static final items. So what do you guys usually do to achieve the similar kind of effect in Kotlin? What do you think is people should do to implement this pattern? Anybody wants to take this up? Like, what's something that you would suggest usually?
Okay, I could speak up. Like coming from the Java background, like we often use utils class and constant class like this, as you mentioned. I would say that I often use objects classes for this. With the constings, it would be like we just have to first create the object of a constant class and then just call the static functions and static variables of that. With the Kotlin object, it's quite simple because we just declare the object, okay. And the Kotlin object also provides a facility that it would be singleton, because the thing is it would be declared only once. It would be only, take the space in the heap only once. So we won't be creating the constants again and again. With the Java thing, it would be like we have to implement the singleton pattern in the Java. First, we have to check, I mean, that singleton pattern first, the private constructor. And then if it is already initialized, then return that already initialized instance. That would be quite cumbersome. I mean, it's already implemented in Java for so many years. And so a lot of developers won't think it's cumbersome, but when you come to Kotlin, it's just only one keyword, object, and that's all. You get the, you know, the your singleton class. And the best
I mean, if I want to go ahead with, say, something similar in, say, Kotlin kind of atmosphere, we can, I think a lot of times people see code which is of this format, that is, you know, and somebody creates an object, and inside that object, we can, like, for example, you can just copy this. Madhu was just saying this is a great thing. You can copy Java code into Kotlin. It converts them directly like this. I think this is something you know, IntelliJ's tools are of course very fantastic for these kind of things. Similarly, like we have this piece of code as well. So if I just paste it here. Right. So let's say you know this is what we had in you know the Java world. We have, say, a const file which has some constant like this. We have some utils written like this. And in Kotlin, we do something like this. So is that a good pattern? Is, I think the question is, and is that what we should do? Does it have any advantages or disadvantages? Or is there something better that we can do about it? Maybe going on to Madhu as well for this.
So I've been using object classes in variety of ways. So the problem comes with object classes when, let's say, you want something to be a singleton. This is very much tied to the concept of hoops. So I'm just giving a heads up there. So when you want a singleton object, so what do you put in the constructor? What do you want to initialize it with, right? All is well when you have a singleton with simple initialization logic that doesn't have to go fetch something in the background and then initialize, right? In those cases, object really shines. So if you can just load everything into memory, it just without doing any background loading and all, right? So you declare an object and you're guaranteed to get, you're always guaranteed to get a single object, but if you want to use that singleton, but somehow have references to, let's say, your database, right? Mm-hmm. And you can only initialize database, let's say, not in the main thread, whatever, in the background restriction, right? And you still want to use this object. Now there is a trouble, right? Now, how do you expose it? Because in the initialization time, you don't have your DB. But later on in different parts of the app, you want that DB because you think that, you know, ideally you would say that, hey, my entire object app context, I'll call it app context, is a singleton object. I want my references of database, everything here, right? Now that's where object becomes tricky. And I don't think you should, if you really want to do that, you should put a lot of concurrency checks to the method where you have setters, you know, set methods for these kind of reference objects.
Basically, you're saying like in a big project, what the problems happen with global statics. So
So you will
have the same slippery slope.
Yes, you will eventually end up there. So you definitely have to draw a line on, you know, what is the problem your object class is solving, right? So you really need to understand from how many thread context. So because just guaranteeing singleton might sound very good at the beginning, but then you start using it in a way that you are not supposed to, like somewhere in the code in some thread you set something in the object and you expect it to be present in another thread reference just because it is singleton, right? So these kind of things will start proving difficult, so you got to be careful. I think that has been in my experience so far. Objects, constants, things like that, you know, object declaration is good. But if you want to hold a real singleton, then with references to your resource classes that access to network or DB and all, you should probably refrain, because you will eventually see that, hey, now this object can actually become a class, and I have to ensure that I do double locking with a class. So, yeah. And people either solve it with coin or dagger or any other tools. But what I am trying to say here is, object is good, but you need to know the purpose.
Correct.
And its usages across your app, or else you will, it will throw, give you surprises very soon.
Right,
and
right.
You know when to change your object to class.
Okay. Anything to add here, Pulkit, for this? You're still in
the room. So I used to use a lot of objects in the past, but recently I've started working on the Opera project. That is actually, that is one of the best code project that I've been working on the open source, and they are mentored by one of the some of the few Google employees. They have been working for Kotlin like for about 4 or 5 years, and they have been working for Java like 10-15 years. So they are way more experienced than me. And then I got to know about the pitfalls of the object methods and the way we do things. So yeah, things like this is good actually. I do prefer to use object thing, but as Madhu said that there are pitfalls of that, like especially for when you have the thread things. So yeah, if you should you should use this very wisely. You shouldn't be using this singleton pattern too much. This may cause some issues in a big object, but when you're starting with Android Dev or simple Kotlin stuff, I would say that you can definitely start using that. You would find this very useful as compared to your singleton pattern that you do for the single classes. So
I would have something to add to this as well. I think a very good tool that we all should use, especially if you are working with, so this is, I just want to prefix by saying, if you're working with Kotlin, that will end up running on JVM. So what I'm going to show you right now is not something that might hold a lot of ground if you are working with Kotlin native or with Kotlin in JavaScript or something like that. But like an atmosphere, using Kotlin on JVM on the server, you're using Kotlin with Play or Spring Boot, these kind of things, or if you're using Kotlin with Android. So in these kind of things, I think a very useful tool is, if you just open, tools, and then there is Kotlin, and you can do is show Kotlin bytecode here. And in Android Studio and in IntelliJ All IDs, you have this. So what this shows is, the Java bytecode that this class will, or this object or whatever will turn into. And then you can actually click on decompile. And that basically gives you the, it will decompile it into Java. Okay, so this kind of now starts showing you that when I write my Kotlin code like this, what is the, corresponding, thing in Java that it would have looked like. Okay, it's not really converting Kotlin to Java, to be very honest, because this code it will not be able to, compile directly. There are certain problems here, but it is kind of, you can, substitute this for doing the opposite. Like you can paste Java code and it turns into Kotlin. Doing the opposite is directly as such not possible, but going to bytecode and decompiling it can give you a bit of insights. And the biggest part of that insight is, for example, this URL to string is that, as you can see, tag and base URL is actually constant. They are public static final as it is. I had picked them up from const.java. It's exactly the same form they are retained. Okay. But URL to string, in fact, although I had copied code which was static in nature, in my end result, it's not actually static in nature. As you can see, it's a dynamic function. It's part of the instance of util. And utils class has an instance, which is basically a singleton instance. And when you try to, call, say, utils.url.toString, what really happens in that sense when you have a code, let's say I'll just go and write a main function below it, and then you start to understand that. So if I have a main function here, and if I try to do, utils dot URL to string, and actually I pass say some URL and some string. In that case, what will essentially happen is I'll just do this step again. I think we need to have. So, this code will not run, of course. This is not a valid URL. I'm just showing it to see, what code it gets formed into. So you will see that my actual call is not utils.url to string. It's in fact utils.instance.url to string instead of that. Okay. So these are kind of things where, the exact Java code that you copied from, you don't end up with the exactly same thing. How you can achieve that is there are some annotations in Kotlin which the Kotlin compiler understands. So, for example, if you write JVM static here, okay, and then you do this, and if I just take a look at the same process again, if I go to show Kotlin bytecode now, and if I decompile this, so now as you can see, my URL to string function is actually a public static final function the way I would have wanted it to be. Okay. So these are, I think, kind of Java and Kotlin interoperability that you should take care of. And I believe if you go to the Kotlin Lang website, they have an entire section on Java Kotlin interoperability. And even the Android developer documentation also has docs on this. So when you're working on this kind of an environment where there is Java code and Kotlin code, you are mixing them together, and finally the product is going to be running on a JVM, then you should keep this thing in mind that there are certain @ JVM kind of annotations, and they all do some special stuff which makes it more compatible with the original Java thing that you were trying to achieve. So that's something, it's a good thing. Once you start off with Kotlin, go across the basics. It's a good thing to keep in mind. Helps keep your memory footprint and a performance better if you have these things in your toolkit. Cool. I think let's do a fun thing now. And the fun thing is I will go through all three of you one by one, and you guys name three features in Kotlin, three things that you can do in Kotlin that you feel are game changers to you. Okay. That you feel like, have completely made your life better when you write code with Kotlin, or, any pattern which is possible via Kotlin, which you see on a daily basis helps you prevent problems from occurring or helps you write a lot less code, whatever it is. The top three, things in Kotlin that you really, really love, and at least one, maybe you can speak of two as well, at least one thing that you wish Kotlin had, or or anything in Kotlin that is not really you feel nice, which you feel is a hindrance, which you feel can be better, which you feel is kind of a problem in Kotlin. And so let's start with, I think, Madhu, three things you really love about Kotlin, you really recommend, and one thing you feel missing or you want to change about it.
Can I list more, or we are just restricted to three?
No, you have to restrict to three, because otherwise we will get we will not be able to finish in time, because even if I am allowed to say more than three, I will list probably 10 as well, but top three, you have to stick to that.
My top three would be data classes, suspend functions,
right,
and sealed classes.
Okay, so let me actually write that down. So for Madhu, it has been data classes, and you said sealed classes.
Yes.
And extension functions.
No, suspend.
Oh, suspend.
You can add extension also, if you give me options for four.
No, I'll not give you four. but yeah, so anything that you want to change in Kotlin, if it could be better, or something that's missing.
Yes. One of the things with data classes, I know this is against. So data with data classes, soon the problem becomes about the Hoops concept of whether you are going to compose an object inside your data class or you want to inherit. Obviously, data class doesn't support inheritance, but right. sometimes you would be like, oh, I've written so much, if instead of data class, if it were to be class, I would have inherited and things would have worked, but now I have to embed another class and it's a gigantic mess, right? And it really becomes huge mess when in middle of the project, you're like, oh, I need to add something and there's a base class, my serializers would work.
Correct. That's very interesting, I think.
Yeah, that is something I usually run into, and with JSON or Moshi or anything, you just add the new field in your base class and you're done, right? All your children classes get all those fields.
Right. Very interesting. I think I completely agree with you on that. I think data classes have been, created with a very specific use case in mind, and that is just for modeling things, not to give you all the advantages of object-oriented programming there. It's just to model, serialization and deserialization. But interesting, okay, good few points. Let's move to Pulkit. Really good things you find?
So for me, first, the extension functions, I use them a lot, especially the apply function, the let function that we use. Okay. And after that, the special thing about the Kotlin that I love is everything is an expression that you can return from if, you can return from when. That really saves a lot of time, and that is the best thing I would have in every language. So that's one thing. And other than that, I would say lambda functions. The way we do use a lambda function or the receiver functions, we can say that they are actually quite useful. And in fact, lambda functions, extension functions cannot exist without the lambda functions. They are part of they're part of them.
Correct. Of course. So yeah, I think somebody who moves from, I think, especially from Java C# kind of language to Kotlin, does appreciate that. It gives you the same world, but it allows lots of functional programming in it as well now. Something you feel missing in Kotlin or you hate about any feature in Kotlin, something that shouldn't have been there or like that.
I haven't thought of it like this in that way, so I can't really comment on that. That is something that I would miss in the language itself.
Okay.
So yeah, there's anything. Yeah.
Okay. So we'll go with any there. So somebody likes Kotlin a lot.
Right.
Rohan, what all things have you used in Kotlin? The top three things you really like, features that you can't live without.
First thing, infix operator. I mean, it really makes the code like English language, seriously.
Okay.
Then there's obviously suspend functions. It really makes the code synchronous.
Right. And
then the lambda functions are the one which really makes the code easily writable. That's the one.
Okay.
I really use lambda function. And the hate thing, I would say, am I allowed to say two?
Yeah, two, sure. Functions? I think the negative part, you can go more than one. I just wanted at least one.
The first thing, if you are checking for nullability for only one object, then you can surely use dot let operator, and that's really nice syntax. But what suppose if I have to check 2-3 more objects for nullability, then it becomes a hassle over there. Even after the check nullability, the lint just shows that it could be null, and then I just have to, as a developer, I have to put the double banks for the compiler stuff only. I know that that it won't be null, but still I have to put it. That's the thing. Nested nullability. For that, Kotlin introduced the contracts, but it's still a overkill. The Kotlin contracts are overkill. Seriously, just for checks. Then the issue which I faced more regarding the compiler plugin stuff. Kotlin has introduced compiler plugins, but there's very less support for developing compiler plugins. And the compiler plugins, they do make the change. They do make the code in the compilation stuff. Normally, the JVM bytecode, we don't have the, opportunity to tweak the compiler stuff. The right. compiler plugin stuff is not that much great currently.
Okay. Good point, and it's a pretty interesting point, and only people who have worked around with those parts of the language kind of share this pain. I kind of empathize with that. Also, I believe this thing, a lot of people, when they're discussing about like, say, Java versus Kotlin, or whether to use Java or Kotlin, or like comparing the ecosystem of Java to Kotlin, or like if Java is dying down and if Kotlin is the new way to build things and Java will not exist in the next couple of years. I see a lot of discussions kind of like that in Hacker News and Reddit and those kind of places. Yeah. So I think what a lot of people miss is that when you're using Kotlin with Java, like in Android or in a J2E Java backend kind of a atmosphere, what people don't see is the existence of Java for like 30 years that Java brings in to this whole ecosystem, the annotation processing, the bytecode analysis. So there is so much things that you can do in, I think, for example, there is this Google library called Jetify. If people have worked with Android, people have moved from Android.support to Android X. Anybody has been around with Android for that much time when that happened, you would know that there is a Gradle plugin which can take all of your pre-compiled jar files and R files and convert the class names and the function names in that. So that's a bytecode transformation that's happening. It can actually transform the name of your classes and all. It's a very powerful thing. And it's all part of the tooling ecosystem. And all of these things are there. And that's why it's so easy to work with these kind of languages. Compared to that, I think compilation stage changes that you can do in Kotlin, it's still very nascent. The compiler people have been, the outer community, not just the people who work on the compiler, like the open source community, they have been tinkering with the compiler for only 2 or 3 years, to be very honest. And what all is possible using that, there's a lot to go. Even like annotation processing in Kotlin, all of you guys using Retrofit or JSON or Moshi, these kind of libraries, the annotation processing that happens in Kotlin, it's way slower than how it happens in Java, because when you want to do annotation processing in Kotlin, the Kotlin classes have to be transformed into Java classes. There is a step for that. People who work on big Android projects dread that step. It's called KPT Kotlin stubs. And that's like the step that takes an entire lifetime when you're compiling. But so that slows down your Android build times a lot when you're doing that. And definitely there are these kind of things. So I think Java is not going anywhere. There are a lot of things that are there in Java, which are hidden from you, not just the language syntax, but the compiler plugins and those kind of things, which Kotlin still has a lot of ground to cover in that. Okay. I'd like to, move ahead to, another question that we have is from YouTube. Somebody called Death Code has asked this question. How does named parameters in function call work in Kotlin when Java doesn't support it? Interesting question here. And again, like I said, you should, of course, try this thing out. Try out decompiling into Java, and that will give you a bit of visibility into that. I'd love to do that step for you. Let's say we just have this quickly make this out.
But there's one thing that the named argument is also a nice thing in Kotlin. Like that's actually a really headache that we don't have to remember the order of that in which we actually name the arguments, or then we created the function. We don't have to remember that. We can actually use it as random as we want. So that is a really good thing about Kotlin.
So let's say we have this function called greet, and it takes a person's name as a string, and it takes greeting as a string. Okay, and what it will do is it will just print ln this thing. Hello. Sorry, I think. So this kind of function, if I want to call this function, I think we can call it with, so just zoom in the code a bit. Yeah. So we can call a greet with the name of a person. Like I can call maybe, Pulkit with hello, something like this. So if I run this, the output you would see, hello Pulkit, how are you, is, I think, just give it a while for this to compile. Yeah. So, hello Pulkit, how are you? Like it says. So we can also do is we can call greet, and we can call it like this. We can do greeting equal to hello. We can write the greeting first, and then we can write the name of the person after that, like this. Okay. So if you do that way, then also it will give you the same result as you will see. Right. So how is this possible? You can just go to show the Kotlin bytecode for this again, decompile that, and you'd find that, it basically transforms your code. It creates those as variables first, and then it calls the function with ordered variables only. So no magic. I think there is very little magic. A lot of things that look like magic, you can just go under the hood using the decompilation step and see that the compiler is just doing extra work for you. I think it's true for every language. Don't think there is a lot of magic going on. There is, of course, a very simple explanation that lies beneath your compiler. And that's why if you have a function with named parameters in Kotlin, when you call it from Java, then you won't be able to use the named parameter style, because named parameters do not actually exist in the final product. They just exist in your syntax while you're compiling the code. So if there are any more questions anybody has on your code usage, people can feel free to ask about that. I want to go into my next question again for all three of you again. Maybe we can do it in the same order again. So I don't want to restrict the number of answers that you can give this time. You can pick one or two or whatever. What are the next two, three things you can say? No, don't list 20 things. Let's keep the number of numbers that we can handle. Next few frontiers for Kotlin, you feel, is whether it is Kotlin multi-platform or doing backend work with Kotlin, or Kotlin native, or using Kotlin to share code between iOS and Android. Lots of different things, maybe a few things that you guys know about, I don't know as well. So what do you think, next couple of years are really promising opportunities that exist with Kotlin? What do you think? What do you, if you have to bet your money on, what are the things that you feel Kotlin will come and take over and change the world in? Let's go with the same order. Madhu, if you wanted to take this one first.
I'm going to really bet on the multi-platform.
Okay.
The Kotlin's approach to multi-platform is very different from what other platforms are targeting.
Right.
I'd like to expand a little bit on that instead of just throwing a word, because when people think about multi-platform, they might actually think about having, one language being written and the UI shows up in both places, but that's not what Kotlin multi-platform is trying to do. Kotlin multi-platform is trying to ensure that the Kotlin code that you've written is basically running natively on different places, on the JVM, and on the Objective-C runtime, on the JS, and things like that. So what it essentially means, for me at least, I've been building apps and server code for a long time, is ability to put a lot of business logic that packs in together your network requests and the databases, right? And we've been able to successfully try that out and I'm pretty confident that this will have a good future.
Okay. So Kotlin multi-platform, sharing common code in iOS and Android is what you're thinking.
Yes.
Okay. Pulkit, you wanna take a stab at this? What do you think are the next few things that Kotlin is coming up? You're really excited about maybe one or two things.
Kotlin and KMP is one of the things, Kotlin multiple platform is one thing that I'm seeing grow a lot in the open source. There are a lot of people who are coming up with a lot of template projects that you can use, and you can make a Kotlin multiple platform application, not just Android or iOS. You can make web apps, you can make server side code, you can do a lot of things. And if I'm not sure how it would go along with the in the future, but if that really do, like if there's something like that that it can do perform well, so I would say that would be one of the best things that you can have, because right now we do have to write our server code in the we have to make our server code in JS or anything like Django or MapyPy. Not Django, Python, JS, anything, it can be anything. And then we have to do Android, then we have to do iOS, and we have to make classes all again and again. We have to write code. That is actually not the way it should be there. Like, it should be a common thing that we can use, a common classes, and you should share code that we should have the same logic throughout the application level or throughout the entire platform. So right. Yeah, the Kotlin multi-platform is one of the things that we can use. And along with Kotlin multi-platform, we have in the Kotlin, we have a thing called Flows, and Flows is a new thing. I haven't really explored that much, but I've been seeing that. I've been following how does Flows work, and Kotlin Flows basically can replace Kotlin Flows along with the coroutines can replace the whole use case of RxJava, and keeping that along the Kotlin ecosystem that is not specific to any Android or anything, we can use it throughout the multi-platform. And if that's the thing, we can use it on iOS or web. That would really save a lot of time for me as well as a lot of developers. So yeah, these are the two things that I would say that would be a game changer in the future. For the Kotlin.
Okay. Nice. What are your thoughts, Rohan?
Am I audible?
Yeah.
So, I mean, Kotlin multi-platform is a bet. I mean, most people are talking about the multi-platform, but I would like to go a little different. I would like to talk about the server side. Ktor is really a great platform, which it's completely based on the asynchronous thing. Right now, the only problem which I see in the kit, not problem, but the limitation, it's based on JVM, and because the JVM boot up start is itself a problem. I mean, the JVM boot up start is itself slow. That's why the Ktor is laggy. Otherwise, the Ktor stuff is really great. One thing which could enhance the Ktor is the Ktor plus Kotlin native. The work is going along these lines, Ktor using the Kotlin native. If this thing works, because the Kotlin native, the JetBeans, the way they are targeting Kotlin native is quite different. Currently, we at Quarkus using Graal VM, which also converts the bytecode to the native stuff. That's how we are targeting the native stuff. But Ktor with Kotlin native could fast the boot up start, and decrease the memory footprint.
We can think of probably Go or Rust level performance from code written in Kotlin. With server code, get all the benefits of Kotlin language, and then finally runs as a native binary as in JVM. That's really promising. I think I am also looking forward to that. How that will pan out? Definitely, yeah.
I would like to add a little bit to Ktor from my experience.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. So as I've been telling, we've been tinkering around with multi-platform a lot, and we actually wanted to ensure to have a common networking logic apart from the logic. So we tried Kator client actually, and I think it's a beautiful replacement for OKHTP that has been de facto for a long, long time. And the expressivity of Kator client is very good. It kind of works on Objective-C, and this was the story 3 months back. But we did at the limitation of Kotlin multi-platforms, you know, concurrency runtime is really, really is putting kind of blockades for Kator's adoption for multi-platform. What I felt. So if I think there's a lot of work going on the concurrency side to have a similar coroutine and the way we work with go on the JVM path on native. But at this point, from my personal experience, I've not been able to share a network logic between multiple platforms. Concurrency or the multi-threaded runtime of KMP is going to improve. It will be super promising. I'm actually excited about it to go into the stack of Kotlin multi-platform.
Right. Definitely. So interesting few threads starting from here. I think Kotlin multi-platform is something everybody is pretty excited about. And I think the most interesting thing about Kotlin multi-platform, I feel, is that when different people say Kotlin multi-platform, they mean different things. So there is, the ability to run, if I have to pick the same answer out myself, I think what's really exciting is ever since, like, you know, you can do everything in web, like front end plus back end, everything in one language, that is JavaScript. You can write front end code, you can write back end using Node.js, and if you don't have and you can make mobile apps using a lot of tools like Cordova, which is a web view basically, but you can also use something like, you know, React Native or Native Script. So I think the 2010 to 2020 decade has been a lot of winning for JavaScript, I have felt. And like, if you are a JavaScript developer, you can literally, you know, make a, you know, a true full stack setup for, say, you want to start up your own company or something. You can make your web app, you can make your even mobile app, you can make your website, you can make your backend, and you can make all of these using JavaScript. I'm not going into the pros and cons of that. I'm just saying that it can be done. Many things have their pros and cons, but I'm just saying it can be done. What I personally am really interested in is like the different experiments that the Kotlin team is doing with, say, Kotlin JS, which allows, so it again has a lot of dependencies. Like your JavaScript code, if it has got TypeScript type declarations, then Kotlin actually plugs in really well with that. You can write in Kotlin, it turns into JavaScript. The transformed code is also very readable. It's understandable. It does not turn into some, you know, garbage like bytecode kind of a thing. It's still source code, and you can basically I think the journey will start with a lot of people turning, say, libraries like, you know, Base64 encoding. People will write a library like that in Kotlin. It can be turned into JS. It can be used as a front-end library, as a back-end library in Node.js. It can be turned into Kotlin native and compiled into, a proper EXE kind of a native binary that can be used anywhere. And that library can be used as a, you know, a jar or something in an Android app as well. So there's going to be like a lot of, I think, business logic level consolidation that I feel can happen, where you're writing in Kotlin once and it can be used as a component within an Android app, within an iOS app, within a web app, within your server as well. And I think that will grow. I feel there definitely is a possibility, too early to say, but maybe, you know, we can write entire modules, entire components, and maybe even the full platform itself, and writing it in Kotlin, seeing the Kotlin code on front end in browsers running as JS, and then, you know, on the server maybe as native, and then on apps as well. So that's a really exciting thing that Kotlin is moving towards. I think right now it's still very nascent. There's a lot of experimental stuff out there. I think, like correctly Madhu pointed out, the you know, the level at which coroutines work on JVM, Kotlin native does not have a similar level of multi-threading and concurrency framework right now out of the box. But those things, I think, will keep coming. So pretty interesting. Now I think again another round of questions to all three of you one by one. I would like to say, so people who are learning say Kotlin, and they might have been even using it for a while, maybe say a few weeks or months they have used, what's a, you know, a learning path that you would suggest? Like, what are the things that people should try out first? What are the things they can do after that? What some experimental stuff they can try out? What is like your ideal structure for learning and implementing Kotlin in your daily workflow? Maybe you can go with a reverse order this time. So Rohan, maybe starting with you.
Okay. So firstly, I mean, I would start with the play.lang. play.kotlin.lang. I mean, it's a really good thing, and they have a certain code labs too. I mean, for the beginners too, I would prefer to go over there. I mean, as a beginner, then I would go into the JVM stuff, because whether we say that Kotlin is expanding, but still, as you said, it's still nascent. Kotlin is still heavily, depends on JVM. So I would study the JVM thing, that how the JVM works and how the Kotlin and JVM works. So that is the very basic thing, and that would also, I mean, benefit the developer in the future too. Then, according to the platform, I would go. I mean, whether on Android or Kotlin or the server side, that would be differentiated.
Right. So makes for a good strategy. Like Pulkit, what do you say? Or maybe I will come to Pulkit last, because Pulkit is somebody who is teaching actually Kotlin. I will kind of take that as a final word for people to learn. So Madhu has been using Kotlin for quite some time at Hibble as well. So yeah, about, let's say, professional developers, how do you suggest like a trajectory for learning?
My take on Kotlin learning is it depends definitely on the expertise of your programming, right? So, one level could be starting small with the features and exploring features in a way that you make your code more readable, more organized, right? Maybe you are coming from a Java background and you're comfortable with classes, and you're just writing everywhere classes around in Kotlin and retrofitting everything to work. And then slowly you would want to explore the features, right? All right, how do I replace my enums with more decorated sealed classes, right? What the discriminated unions and things like that, right? So how sealed classes are solving things for you there. So you start exploring. I think that you explore by refactoring your code in a way that it becomes more readable. So you use features like builder patterns, use applies in view classes to apply attributes of paint or object or something like that, right? So slowly you actually turn your code, which is more closer to Java. I'm giving you a specific example here of Android, which more or less looks like a Java retrofitting into the Kotlin world because it's cool now, to something that is more Kotlin idiomatic, right? Okay. So one of the things even Rohan pointed out is, why not use infix operators, right? Right, you start using infix operators somewhere, and almost feels like your business logic is becoming a DSL. Right, so I think that would be my suggestion. You know, you start with something you are comfortable with, slowly go into features, explore features, and then put it back as a refactoring into the thing that is already working. Next is exploration on the concurrency part. Right, so you're not going to write production on Android or any other platform without concurrency, right? That I would be surprised if you are not right in doing that. So, I was actually very surprised that Kotlin has features from all languages, all cool features. It's like, okay, you want a lightweight thread, we'll get coroutines. All right, you want a pipeline feature, okay, we'll give you Flow, we're building Flow. All right, you want communicate the CSP mechanism where you communicate messages on a channel. All right, we'll give you a channel, right? So there's everything for everybody coming from every language. So start with that, and they have very good documentation. So definitely go through that. Your understanding of concurrency will not be, you know, as bad or like as not friendly as Java world, right? Because the code, I think the Kotlin world, they're calling it as
structured concurrency. Yeah.
Yes, structured concurrency, right? So that's the word I've been seeing mostly in the Kotlin world. So structured concurrency, really, it is definitely the word. It has a lot of meaning. You will see with suspend functions and coroutines that when you read the code, you are actually understand that it is pretty much a sequential code. But Kotlin is doing magic in, you know, running the pieces of code wherever you want. So start slow, explore features, refactor your code, understand concurrency, make it more performant with concurrency constructs. I think that would be my path.
Right. Finally, coming to Pulkit, taking this conversation towards, you know, more, you know, people who are just beginning with language, maybe not have worked on professional projects a lot, for them, like, what kind of a path do you suggest, where to begin with, what steps to take, in what order?
To be honest, I started with the path that you suggested. I used the same path. I started with something small, then I actually started refactoring my code, and then I finally moved to coroutines. I didn't start with the coroutines immediately when I started with using Kotlin. I started using coroutines about like 8-10 months back. When I've done with the Kotlin basic of the Kotlin. So yeah, that is one thing I would say that Madhu is absolutely correct, that you should follow this pattern only. But as a beginner, like when I started Kotlin, I was doing Java for about 2-3 years, and I had a basic knowledge of the language, how does things work. But if you are a very, like, I would say you have started coding about a year or so, in that case, things like JVM and like concurrency, they don't really matter. You don't have any background context about these knowledge. So, and you won't even understand these things in one go. You need actual production code, understand how these things actually matter in production application. You won't get them. Like right now I'm working on the Opera project, and whenever I try to optimize something, my mentor says that you shouldn't be focusing on that much optimization in the code, because you may overkill that. So you shouldn't do that if that is not necessary. And I think that is true, that I shouldn't be focusing on that optimization of the code. I should be focusing on writing the a much more cleaner code, rather than focusing on the optimization in the first go. Being a beginner, I would say that I'm a beginner. That I've been doing Kotlin for two years, and still I still say that I'm a beginner. I need to learn a lot about Kotlin language. So as a path for learning Kotlin, I would say start with something very basic, like what is nullability. Like the nullability thing in Kotlin is a different thing. You don't see that everywhere. So if you're a beginner, you probably have used Java or C++ or C language, maybe. Or maybe even you have used Python, like schools have started using Python in 11th standard. So you may have used Python. But a lot of these languages do not have like nullability checks Python has the type instance thing, but C++ or Java doesn't have that thing. So you should focus on that thing. Like you should have a basic hands-on with the basic syntax, how does thing actually work. Then you should move to some pattern like the higher order functions, lambda functions. These things, they do well with Kotlin and even the Android. Then I would say that you should go more into some coroutine stuff and the channel flow that we are coming. So that should be the pattern of learning the Kotlin language. So yeah, that's it. There's one thing, like I've taught a lot of people who are actually coming from a no background from programming language, and or a language from C or C++, and when they see the features of the Kotlin, they do get overwhelmed with the language itself. So if they get into like a lot of concepts, like they started figuring out like how this function works and like how this actually works, that would be much much better instead of like trying out different features. Like a student like death code ask how does parameter thing works in Kotlin. So they should focus on that thing, because that decompilation thing actually gives them a lot cleaner look about how things actually work in languages, not just the Kotlin thing. They should get a knowledge about how this actually work inside the any language or anything. So yeah.
Nice. That's a pretty good roundup on I think what all paths we can take for this. So yeah, I think any other questions that anybody has, people who are attending on Zoom or on
I would like to add one point to Pulkit's.
Yeah, sure, go ahead.
Yeah, so while beginning, I mean a lot of Kotlin articles, I mean obviously when you start coding you will read articles, that's not a point, but a lot of articles are you will see that Kotlin is compared to Java stuff most of the time. At that point, I would say community is trying to, push the thing in a Kotlin way. So if the Kotlin community, if the Kotlin community and if the beginners try to understand the Kotlin in the Kotlin way only, not compared to Java, that would be beneficial to them. And that would also, enhance the learning part, because the thing is, when you see it is compared to Java, then the person would try to first jump into the Java stuff. What does this thing mean in Java? Then it will come back to Kotlin thing. The best example I would say the generics one. In the official documentation of the generics, the Kotlin generics are being compared to Java one. So if the person is coming to the Kotlin first and it is trying to let's see what's the generic in Kotlin, the beginner will firstly jump to the Java one, that how the generics works in Java, what are the keywords in generics in Java, and then it will come back to Kotlin and then it will make the comparison all the time. That's a problem I also faced in the beginning, but when I just so after one time I just stopped comparing to Java and just see the things in Kotlin way only, then it was way easier. So that would be my point. If we see the Kotlin in the Kotlin way only, and if the community also tries to push the thing in the Kotlin way, that would be better.
Right. I think a pretty interesting point out there, in fact, about like even the generics as well. Also, like this is not something I think the final what all things to learn and all. I think why I want to add one thing is there's something called Keep, K-E-E-P. That's like the Kotlin team uses Keep for, I'm just forgetting what the full form is. It's Kotlin Evolution and Enhancement, right? Yeah. So Keep is you can go to github.com/Kotlin/Keep, and it's the place where the Kotlin developers write their RFCs, requests for comments, and they write like new features that they're getting added to Kotlin. And I think I picked up the Kotlin Keep on coroutines, and then Eliza Togarev, who is like a famous person, he's a Russian programmer. He used to, he has, I think, won ICPC a few times, and then been like a question setter on ICPC a few times, like when he was like a kid. Now he's like the person at JetBrains who drives a lot of new features in Kotlin. I followed like a lot of his articles on the thought process behind how coroutines was implemented, and I think as general as computer science theory learning, reading the Kotlin Keep on coroutines, it was a, I think, heavy read. In fact, first time I started reading, and I was like, okay, no, I can't just read it in a casual sitting. I will have to take time out to properly sit and understand how they have implemented it. And it was a great learning experience for me. I had to refer back to a lot of other learning material to understand how all of these things work. So yeah, I think once you have gotten through this journey, gotten a basic understanding of how Kotlin works, using Kotlin on a daily basis in your things, I think you can take a look at some of how a language evolves. And you don't see that easily with a language, say like C++ or Java, which are so old languages that not too many new features get added into these languages on a daily basis. And Kotlin is a very fast evolving language. And you can go and see how people who design a language, how they think, how they work, how they add new features, how they implement it, how they have been transforming a language that runs on the JVM into a language that can run anywhere. So that's a very useful source for learning. Of course, I wouldn't recommend that for somebody who is just beginning to use Kotlin. But if you are like a seasoned developer and you've been using it for some time, then I can definitely recommend that as a very useful learning resource. Apart from I think questions from the audience, does anyone of you three have questions for the rest of us? Any questions, anything that you want to discuss? You want to take an opinion from the others? Or any one of you wants to go ahead, have a question anybody has?
Yeah, so I this is mostly targeted to first-time programmers in Kotlin. Mm-hmm. When I learn a new language, I always want to see the result immediately. It could be print hello world, right? And then slowly move on to Android emulator, whatever is the case, right?
Okay.
Right now in the Kotlin world, what it means is, at least as I see, is downloading the IntelliJ if you're not writing Kotlin script. So of course, you can always go to Kotlin Play and try it out. But if you want to write a real small project and really try hands-on, you need to have an IDE. I think the setup process is something I feel is a little hurdle for people. I'm actually comparing to actual beginners to, let's say, a web world where you can bring up VS Code, write HTML, write a small JS, everything runs in browser, and you've written a web app, right? So that feeling, I think, is generally lacking in terms of either it could be Kotlin or Swift. I can compare it to any of those languages, but I feel is kind of a limitation for these set of languages where their general purpose usage is not as much as what we see in the web world.
Yeah, I think something like you take a copy of VS Code or Atom and you write a JS file and there's a run button and it runs. So compared to that, I think here, say a lot of people are on Windows, and if you're not a seasoned developer, if you're a student, you might be on a Windows laptop or a Linux one, you might have installed Linux on your laptop. And in that case, I think you'd face issues even with the Java runtime or even how to install, which version of Java to install. So there is like, I think, a lot of baggage around that. And I saw a really, I think, good trend that I saw with, Dino, which I think the Node.js founder has created a new, alternative to Node.js, Dino, I've been seeing. And so again, it's a whole different thing about can Dino replace Node. But I think one really nice approach I saw in Dino was, instead of having to install Node.js and setting a node path and all of that stuff, there is a single dino.exe. And that is just download the dino.exe. For Windows, it's exe. For other languages, it would be corresponding binary formats. But, you download the dino binary and it can open the console. It can compile and run your project. It can run your script file. And you don't need to worry about, setting up so many things. Which is, I think, if anybody, like people from the community can help improve upon, and if the people who are backing Kotlin are hearing and they can improve upon, that will definitely be a very good step for beginners, because you want to learn a new language, you see very nice syntax on the website and you try to run it and Java not found and restart your computer 2 times, that kind of turns you away. That's definitely true. Very, very good point, I think. But people who are actual beginners seeing this video, who would be seeing this video later, I would say be a little patient and persistent, because that's
the IDE is always there.
Yeah. I can feel that. When I taught students Android Studio, one of the biggest problems that I faced was getting that installed and getting that environment set up. And especially in a Windows, I do use a Mac. And for Mac, things are not that much complicated, I would say. But Windows, if things get messed up, I would say that please Google it. I don't know how to do that. I can't do that because there are things that get trickier. And even if in the Mac, we have to, a lot of time we have to clean the creator files and we have to clean the build files in order to actually build our own projects. So yeah, that's one thing I would say this whole ecosystem is lagging behind. Whether it can be Xcode, I've worked on Swift as well. So I would say that is true for all the things like Xcode, Swift, Xcode, Swift, Kotlin, and yeah, this thing with that.
Kotlin do support a standalone compiler, but the thing is, but still, even setting up that standalone compiler is a pain. I mean, I also remember that. Most of the beginners are still on Windows, and even setting the standalone compiler on Windows is also a pain because with the Java, with the JDK, you just install, click the button, and all the environment path variables set up on Windows. I'm specifically talking about Windows currently here. But with the Kotlin standalone compiler too, you have to manually set up the path, and that's still a pain for the beginners, I would say. And even in the VS Code, you can set up the standalone compiler in your computer, and there's a extension for the Kotlin, but it's not an official extension.
Yeah, that's, since we are on the topic, I think I would definitely thank you, all three of you, to actually bring up this topic. I would just quickly plug this in for people. Definitely use SDK Man. It's a great tool. It works on all three operating systems, and it's my highest recommended way to install Java related stuff, everything. You can install whichever version of Java that you want easily. You can install whichever version of Gradle, Kotlin, everything. So the standalone Kotlin compiler also you can actually install using that. And as you can see, it's very easy to install SDK Man. There are scripts to install it on Windows, for Mac, for everything else. And there are I use SDK Man to maintain the local copy of Kotlin, Java, Gradle, and Maven, all of the Java related stuff my computer using that. So definitely a suggestion for anybody out there, how to, fastest way to get the Kotlin compiler, SDK install Kotlin C. That's something that always works well for me. Yeah.
It also helps in managing different Java versions if you are using.
Yeah. So great. Any other topics that any one of you three want to discuss, or any, like I said, any questions that any one of you three have for the rest of us?
So I have another question. Roman has worked a lot on server side. How are server side things looking? Especially, do you think, I'm actually more interested, do you think it could become a go-to place for building microservices as of today? What is the situation? Can it really compete with Onslaughter that is going to come with Java 13 and all the cool features Java 13 is going to introduce?
I would say Kotlin, it's a competitor, but I would say it's difficult to replace the Java thing because in the server side, a lot of things are Java EE based. They are basically enterprise edition based and they have to follow the specifications too. So we at Quarkus, Quarkus is also Java EE based framework, and a lot of the cloud environments already support the Java environment, like Kubernetes, and we are deploying to Google Cloud and AWS. We are facing problem with the Kotlin. Most of the time we face the problem with that open thing, by default all the classes are closed in Kotlin. We can use all open compiler plugin by the JetBrains, but it's not that much configurable because we at Quarkus, we are aiming at least boot time and least footprint. So we are basically trying a way that we can push dynamically what classes to open. And in the all open, you have to pre-feed the classes so that it can open. That's the problem we are facing. And as I said, Java has already evolved to enterprise edition. Kotlin is still not that much evolved. I mean, for the enterprise edition, but I would say that's also a plus point for that, because when you come to enterprise edition, you have some, limitation restrictions. You have to follow the specification. That also becomes the kind of, you could say, friction for a developer, that you have to follow that. Kotlin is free for that, and I would not recommend that Kotlin to go into enterprise version, because it would restrict the development and your features won't be that much frictionless, and that would be. So for the server side thing, Kotlin is picking up. Kotlin could pick up. Even in fact, when we launched the Quarkus, it was tagged as supersonic subatomic Java framework. But we are slowly adding the Kotlin support, because we know that Kotlin could be the future, and we should integrate the Kotlin. That's why we are adding the Kotlin support. But currently, I don't think so that, it's wholly replaceable. I think both of the things would coexist.
Okay. I think a lot of points are covered there. So if you want to know the direction, probably is I would actually look at Spring projects. And recently as last 1 year, Spring has started taking Kotlin seriously and is making Kotlin as a first-class citizen. So if you look at their samples, just like Android documentation, you have tabs for Java and Kotlin. In the Spring also, you will see whether you want to develop with Java, Kotlin, and Groovy. Of course, Spring has Groovy support too. So I think that's a kind of positive direction for server side. But apart from Spring, I have not much. So whenever I'm stuck on the server side, Kotlin, though, there is a very little help on the internet right now. I think that seems to be a problem.
I would say that, like I said, even in the server side, there are two ways. Spring is not a Java E specification base, so it's a kind of free thing, and that's why it is able to pick up the Kotlin very frequently. I would say that we at the Quarkus, we are using the Java E specification most of the things, and that's why we quite face friction porting the Kotlin and features to the Kotlin. And also while working with the Kotlin thing, I would say the support of Gradle with the Kotlin is seamless, but the Maven is not that much supported. And also, Spring has moved to Gradle, and that's why they were able to integrate quickly. But did a survey, a month back, we just wanted to know that what are the build system is currently most probably used in the server side in the JVM stuff. So it was 65 to 35%. 35% people use Gradle, and 65% people still use Maven for the server side. And Kotlin integration with the Maven is not that much effective. It's been, I guess, 4 months. I'm still working on that issue. I'm supposed to develop a compiler plugin for Kotlin. And the problem we are facing is I have to develop the different compiler plugin for Maven. I have to different compiler plugin for Gradle, and the compiler plugin does the same work only, and that's an overkill, because all the logic, all the stuff is same, but because of the different build system, I have to use different dependencies, and that's kind of overkill. And that's why only Spring is able to pick up the Kotlin first, because they were using Gradle, and also they were quite freely. They were not having Java E specifications. That's why they were able to pick up the Kotlin first as compared to other frameworks. Mm-hmm.
Got it. Thanks for all the explanation.
Welcome.
So I think we are in the last minute of our allocated time frame as well. I think there aren't any further questions from the audience. I think we can wrap up if anybody has last words for people who are learning Kotlin, some words of encouragement. I think we'll just go around everybody once and we'll just wrap up then.
So I think we're starting. Okay, let me.
Yeah, Pulkit, yeah, I can check.
So I would definitely say that you should definitely try out Kotlin language at least once. Even if you do any language, like you do JS, you do Python, you should definitely try out Kotlin 1. And it's not going anywhere anytime soon. Because one thing you can say that because this thing, this language is now being promoted by Google itself. So as you can say, same about the Go language. So you should definitely try out the Kotlin language, and you should give it a try at least once without actually thinking about how it actually works. Kotlin lang, and how you can do various things in Kotlin.
Nice. Rohan, any closing remarks? Yeah, mute.
Sorry. So regarding the Kotlin, I would say I started with the Kotlin with less feature like data classes, but as the Kotlin expanding, I'm quite intrigued how the Kotlin would take the things, and I would say Kotlin is taking the things very differently as compared to other languages. So I would say, definitely keep the eye on the Kotlin, how the Kotlin works, and definitely try out the language, because once you start with the language, I would say that if you get started with the language, starting friction for the language is very less. I mean, Kotlin is for the beginners is easy if you start with the Kotlin Cornish way only. So if you start with the Kotlin and then if you slowly move to other features, so you definitely love the Kotlin.
And just before finally going to Madhu, actually we just have a question that has come in last minute one, which is somebody is asking thoughts on Jetpack Compose. Any one of you have tried it out to share your thoughts on that?
Jetpack Compose, first of all, it is very Android specific, not maybe related to Kotlin, but Kotlin as a language has enabled them to be ambitious in terms of building UI tools like Jetpack Compose. I think I'd put it that way. And Jetpack Compose or its other competitor on iOS, Swift UI, are probably the evolution that has to come to UI, because on the web world, React has changed the paradigm of how to build the UI with state machines. And that took probably 2 years or 3 years to come to the mobile world. And somehow iOS world were able to put it first, but I'm extremely excited about Jetpack Compose. I really want to use it as of today, but my company's saying, hey, it's not in production, so don't use it. But I think when it comes, Jetpack Compose, when it comes to the production, you will just love it. I mean, it's the best way to build the UI is what I presume. Because I've been writing in last 3 days, probably around 60 XML files in Android, right? So I hope not to do that. And I hope Jetpack Compose really, really solves that problem. I think the foundational work with started with coordinator layout, then constraint layout and motion layout and things like that. A very heavy, strong foundation of view hierarchy manager on which Jetpack Compose is going to get built. I'm excited to use it. All full 100% positive thoughts on that. So if you get a chance to use it, use it.
I have a little bit of differing opinion on that actually, and the reason for that is I think it's like a motion of the pendulum. I have seen too long. So I've been programming for too long, and I've read enough about programming history to know that going from declarative markup languages to composable programming language based UI. That is something, at least on the UI world, I have seen it happen this way and that way too many times. So going from one kind, if you have been working with XML files for too long, you see too many of the pitfalls, and then immediately seeing the Jetpack Compose syntax seems little nice, but when you start working on that, that comes up with its own pitfalls as well. So people on the web know this pendulum swing a lot, because they have worked with templating languages like HBS. They have worked with React, which is similar to the composing syntax that we have on Jetpack. I believe, like, that aside, the major challenge is, no UI rendering engine will ever work without good previewability. So they need to work on. So unless, like, when the project size becomes bigger and bigger, you won't be relying on running your code and actually seeing it. So that's the situation that Swift UI is in. That's the situation that Flutter is in. That's the situation that Jetpack Compose is in. If you want, like, wider adopting, then you need a way to preview them easily. And I see the Android Studio team is actually working in that direction. There is a Jetpack Compose previewing plugin. It's very alpha level, but it's there. So that's one thing. The other thing is fighting an ecosystem that is 10 years, 11 years old is also very hard, because Jetpack Compose renders without using Android views. And that means there are going to be hundreds and thousands of awesome libraries written using Java views. And you can't, mix and match them with Jetpack Compose. So how is that going to be like? Because, removing the entire view lifecycle and having new kind of a view rendering engine in Android is not a small change. And it will be as breaking as Swift UI is. You can't use it for old versions of iOS. And at least in iOS, within a new iOS version releasing, I think, 50% of the people migrate within the first few months. It's not the same in Android. So that's also going to be a challenge towards that. So I think these challenges, if they are kind of solved, so then we can get to that. There is one question, I think a small question about Ravi asking Kotlin on VS Code. So I think my suggestion would be to get IntelliJ community version if you can, because that's the best possible way. If you still, like, really, really insist on writing Kotlin on VS Code, that's possible. You can use the CodeRunner extension and make sure that you have Kotlin compiler installed on your laptop. So if you have Kotlin C installed, and you can use the CodeRunner extension, and then on VS Code also you can write Kotlin code. But the beautiful autocomplete and nullability checks and control click auto suggestions and all, they will of course be better if you use the IntelliJ community edition one, or if you are a student, then you can even use the ultimate version for free as well. So that's definitely what I would suggest.
You can use EAP version, early access program, and you will still get the benefit of ultimate.
Yeah, EAP is actually, it's legal to use the ultimate version via EAP, because at all times some version of the EAP is always available. So that's also possible. But yeah, so I think definitely would recommend actually using JetBrains IDEs rather than VS Code. I think adding to, I think, Madhu's earlier point, this is also a challenge. I think VS Code can run on much less resources. It can run on something like a Chromebook or an iPad as well. And that way, I think Kotlin is still not that accessible. If you want to, like, start programming on a Chromebook or on a iPad, it's not that easy. I think play.kotlinlang.org would be your friend in that case. I guess we'll just wrap it up. I think thanks to all of you. Thank you, Rohan, Pulkit, Madhu, all of you guys for turning in for this really nice Saturday afternoon conversation on lots of things about Kotlin, getting started, progressing. So we have covered a lot of those. If there are any further questions, this video on YouTube, people can put your questions there. I think we all would probably visit it once in a while later as well and try to answer your questions. Thank you everybody who turned in. Thanks everybody who asked your questions. Hope we were able to take them up. So thank you guys.
Thanks everyone for participating. I hope you had an information session. We are also, at least myself, I'm still a Kotlin learner, although I've been using quite a long time, but there are always new things I keep learning. I enjoy writing in Kotlin. In fact, I learned a little bit of things here in today's panel discussion too. So learning Kotlin is definitely going to be an enjoyable ride.
Right. So yeah, okay. Bye then, guys. Have a nice
day. Bye bye.
All of you.
Bye bye.
Bye.
Bye.